I think a maker is kind of an inventor. And for me, I grew up with my father's influence, and he had made his own loom. And the first looms that I used were from his, you know, he had made the loom from scratch. But I've made tools. I have a 12-foot loom that I designed that uses a motor. I've designed a plying machine that uses a motor as opposed to my foot to run a spinning wheel. And I also have one in the makes for an adjustable speed plier. And I have also developed the tools for warping our looms, which are the basic skeleton of the weave.
I'm Lisa Trujillo. I was born Lisa Diane Rockwood. I was born in San Diego, California.
My name is Irvin Trujillo, and I'm 7th generation here in Chimayo. I was born in Los Alamos in 1954. Went to school in Los Alamos and graduated from UNM with an engineering degree. Worked as an engineer for a while. Now I'm weaving. Well, I started weaving when I was 10, and I learned from my father the techniques to make a blanket or a rug. And I did some independent study, or we did. We did an independent study in museum collections. I've taken workshops from international tapestry artists, and have done a lot of exploratory work. Well, I started dyeing after high school in 1973-4, around there. And my father had been a teacher at El Rito Vocational School here in northern New Mexico, and he had class notes and recipes for using natural dyes to dye wool. He taught spinning and weaving as part of his curriculum. As I got older, I started learning other things besides the dyeing. But as far as a professional dyer, I would say around 1984, 85, around there, I started dyeing wool for the shop. And I was using natural dyes like cochineal for reds, and indigo for blues, and madder root for oranges and rusts, and logwood for purples. And I was using Brazil wood for pinks and also purples, and chamisa, which is a native plant, for yellows, and also goldenrod, and yellow onion skins, black walnuts for browns. And some of them were from here that I could collect, and some of them I had to buy or import, buy from importers.
We only weave with two sheds. So there's one set of threads that's at the bottom of the shed, and one set of threads that's at the top of the shed. And at any one time, when we're doing tapestry, we're making a choice as to whether it comes up from the bottom of the shed, and whether you can either turn around on that thread or you can go and take the other thread. So at any one time when we're doing tapestry, there is a binary choice of how it travels.
Weaving had an early influence in terms of computers because of that, either being over or under.
Yeah.
And so if you look at any textile, not just Rio Grande textiles, the choice is either over or under. And that's it. I mean, I did some pieces about the Hispanic culture, or the Northern New Mexico culture, and how, historically speaking, just like today, you're looking at our views today, and they change, evolve. And so I've used that in my work.
I think that this place was kind of isolated enough, especially from the Industrial Revolution. So we were far enough away from factories that people kept making things. So the weaving tradition never died. It didn't, it, it, we talk about revivals, but it never really just went away. It transformed, and it did that a lot of different times, many times through the history, but it never went away. People needed blankets, and they needed rugs, you know, so they recycled their fabrics and you know, that they had for clothing into their, you know, floor coverings. And in a sense, we were protected by isolation and poverty too, that these things needed to keep going. I think it's an exciting thing. I like the idea of, you know, it's about learning to take some composite material, some material, and turn it into something useful, and that all through time humans have been doing that. And those skills that have been learned all through time are really varied and you know, very highly developed.